the revival series. At the beginning of the year here in 2016, some of you weren't here, some of you were, but I shared with you in the book of Esther about a time to shine that God had spoken to my heart, that it is the time that we shine to our local communities. And as you can see here on the screen, there's four things that I charged the church with to commit to doing. Commitment is more than just saying I'll do it. It's putting it into action. But one of those was to commit together every Sunday. Now, this morning it doesn't look quite as full, but since the beginning of the year, our average attendance has been about 30 additional people. And I thought, well, to some degree that's worked. But then when I look at our attendance list and see that so often there's so many things that pull us away, and at times we have almost 200 people missing on a Sunday morning that'll be here the next week, I think that we have to come together. If we want to see God's hand move in revival, we've got to come together stronger. And also the pledge to a personal time of fasting and prayer. And I'll be sharing some more about that with you even later today. But number three is one item. I've had different people come to me later and said, I've heard from God, and this is what God's speaking to my spirit. And can it, you know, align with the church, and how can we make this happen? I ask you to determine to hear from God for yourself and be able to make that link to the vision that we have. And then number four is to quickly reach out and bless others. And we've been trying to do that here in the next couple weeks. I'm going to try to get more mentors and relationships. We told you how we're going to reach out through the year with Vacation Bible Schools and Heaven's Gates and Hell's Flames, a concert and things like that. But individually, we need to reach out to the communities. I have been myself involved with the schools like never before. I've been communicating with the elementary schools to mentor some families personally. And I guess me and Peggy are getting kind of older, but next Sunday morning, you'll have to pray that the fire that I'm going to preach about that God gives me, because until 2 o'clock in the morning, we're going to be chaperoning the after prom of the high school. Peggy and I and Sarah and Matt, we basically have come to conclusion that alcohol has destroyed this community. I can hear an amen. You know, when I first came here, all I noticed was those party plates. And I was grieved about it. But there's people and families in the community have decided that we don't want that for our kids after prom. And we want to have a wholesome activities and things at the school where they're safe and they can go. But we need chaperones. So they asked me if I would be willing. I said, yes, I'm willing. I'm going to be involved. But I want us to reach out and bless others. You know, through the weeks since the opening of the year, I was instructed by the Holy Spirit, and we heard through words of knowledge and prophecy that we were to prepare for what God is about to do here. And he spoke to me about things personally and with the family and corporately with the church, personally identifying truth and lies and deception in our hearts. And I preached on those things and asked whether the gifts and the things of God we were manipulating or not. Do you know people of God can manipulate things? We talked about Simon the sorcerer, how he wanted the Holy Spirit for the wrong reasons. So not for selfish purposes, we shouldn't want him. Then I shared a few messages, and I'm just trying to catch you up a little bit, because God allowed me to go back and say, where were we and where are we going? I want to know where we're going to. The next areas were about spiritually being in the right seats in the house of God, not getting in places we shouldn't be. There are some wrong places to be, and there's right places to be. And then I began to minister about the home and where everything in revival starts in your home. If your home's not right, revival can't be in the church. So those are things that I was wanting to share. Do you remember what revival does? I think it's here on the screen. Revival awakens our hearts to an increased awareness of the presence of God, a new love for God, a new hatred for sin, and hunger for his word. Here on the screen, the three steps that I'm sharing in revival. Last week it was the promises of revival. This week it's the sounds of revival. We heard a song, you know, about God, you know, being not dead. And there's sounds of revival that are ringing, they should be. And then next week, the fire of revival. You know, last week in the message that I ministered, it was a good message, wasn't it? I didn't hear that real good. It was a good message. I know because it came from God. When it comes from God, it has to be good because it's what he wants for our church. But I ministered on the 200, the 70, and 3. The 200 was 200 years before Cyrus, a man named Cyrus, was ever named, before he was ever born, before he was ever conceived, that Isaiah prophesied that he would be the one that would be the initiator, that would make a proclamation to bring revival to the children of Israel. That put on the shelf 70 years before Cyrus was born. Jeremiah, the prophet Jeremiah in Jeremiah 29:11 that I read so often. I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future. He was saying 70 years before that the land has to rest. You're going to be sent away from the land and you're going to be in captivity. But God will bring you back. And then I shared with the three years ago what a man of God shared with this church. And I may share it again. But on the screen in Daniel 9:2, there was a transition that began to take place. It said, during the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, learned from reading the word of God as revealed to Jeremiah the prophet that Jerusalem must lie desolate for 70 years. So I turned to the Lord God and pleaded with him in prayer and fasting. I also wore rough burlap and sprinkled myself with ashes. This morning, I'm going to be reading out of the book of Ezra, and this is not my main text here, but I want to read from Ezra 1, chapter 1, if you want to turn there. I've been told before, because I put so much on the screen, it makes it easy, and people, I don't know if it's the right word to be lazy, but if you're not searching, you should be checking on your pastor, knowing what he's preaching, knowing that it's the word of God. I don't want you to just take what I say. I want you to know for yourself. But Ezra chapter 1, verse 1. In the first year of King Cyrus of Persia, the Lord fulfilled the prophecy he had given through Jeremiah. He stirred the heart of Cyrus to put his proclamation in writing and to send it out throughout his kingdom. This is what King Cyrus of Persia says. The Lord, the God of heavens, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth. He has appointed me to build him a temple at Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Any of you or his people, now listen to that, any of you, he was saying, any of you that want revival, you have a right. Any of you, whoever his people, may go to Jerusalem in Judah to rebuild this temple of the Lord, the God of Israel who lives in Jerusalem. And may your God be with you, whoever this Jewish remnant is found, or wherever this Jewish remnant is found. Let their neighbors contribute toward their expenses by giving them silver and gold supplies for the journey and livestock, as well as a voluntary offering for the temple of God in Jerusalem. You know, we find here in Ezra that there's a remnant that is being allowed to return to Jerusalem under a man called Zerubbabel. In verse 23, or the second chapter, it begins to share all the different people. There were 50,000 people that decided to go back to Jerusalem. Here we're talking about a 1,000-mile journey. This was not an easy way to go. You'll find out Daniel and some of those that were older men, they stayed back. They didn't go forward. But 50,000 decided to go back. And in the second chapter, I looked at verse 23, and it caught my eye because there was a town named Anathoth, a town of 128 people, it records here. In the history, it's the same place that Jeremiah had spoke about when he was in the prison and someone had come and allowed him to redeem something that it was not even possible. He couldn't even have land, but he had the first rights to it to be able to purchase it. And I can remember years ago that God spoke to my heart, 7 years before I came to Wapak, that I read that one night and on a Saturday evening and before I was to minister, and God spoke to me as clear as you can be. I mean, just with almost an audible sound, the most I'd ever heard. And he said, go buy a field. And that night, I shared that in my message, and people for 7 years began to give me monies to go buy a field. I shared with you a month before I came to Wapak, I thought I had missed God. I tell you that sometimes. You think after a while, it's been too long. And after I shared that, I offered to give the money back to the different contributors, and they said, no, if God spoke that to you, it'll come to pass. I came to Wapak, and this is the land that God redeemed. He began to say, this is the place. So this Anathoth, the town, it was just 128 people, just a small place, but God put it in their hearts to go back with the 50,000. You know, I thought the earth or the ground had rested for 70 years. It was the time. God knew exactly what he was doing. But something happened once they began to return to Jerusalem and laying the foundations. Things got busy and the work got hard. But the local Samaritans that there, you know, when you're gone for 70 years, when the people of God have vacated a place, Satan moves in. You know that? He moved in, and over those 70 years, the Samaritans had taken over everything. They liked the control of the land. They liked the control on both sides of, you know, the borders. They wanted to be able to do what they wanted to do. And so they observed the Israelites going back after they had prayed a while and that they had sacrificed and done the right things. And about the second year, they began the foundations. And the Samaritans began saying, well, let us help you. You know, we'll serve and worship your God too. And Zerubbabel and the force of Israelites said, no, God said this to us. This is something that God's people are supposed to do, not just the heathen of the land. And they refused that. Well, that made the Samaritans mad. And the Samaritans began to write letters, you know. And over time, the letters reached the right parties and all work was stopped. The revival that was supposed to be was quenched. I read here in the scripture, it says that Zerubbabel, for almost 16 years, 15 to 16 years, the revival stopped. The foundations were laid, but everything stopped because of the oppression. You know, different times God has spoke to this church and said, don't be surprised if you get opposition. You know, there's things, you know, at one time people talked about this church and said this was a cult and things like that because they didn't understand why we were even here. I remember when we dedicated the church, it was the person that dedicated says, don't let this be like every other church. It's here for a reason. And I truly believe that. But Zerubbabel had help with Zechariah and Haggai. They began to encourage him. You know, it takes sometimes younger people to come along beside you and say, you know, God gave you something to do, and now it's up to you to do it. So they began to have a desire to see that temple rebuilt again. So there was a new king called Darius, and Darius says, you know, if you read Daniel in the lion's den, Darius saw God's hand on Daniel. And Darius basically is again instructed with a letter to go back and search the history books. Now, some of you are not history majors, and you don't even like history. You didn't like it in school. But I want you to know history will come around and it'll repeat itself. And there's things that are foundationally true in the house of God. So King Darius instructs them to go back to the history books and see what Cyrus had said. You know, it had been 16 years since Cyrus says, you know, go back and do these things. But he's the king now and he wants to find out. He confirms that the decree of Cyrus was true and they were allowed to build. So the work resumed. But after 20 years, it took almost 20 years from the time that Cyrus said revival can start, that temple was built. It was restored and the temple was dedicated, but the inhabitants of the land didn't like it still. There was accusations made against the Jews. They wanted the land. They just wanted to be in control. And little by little, even though revival had been sprung up, it died very, very quickly. 30 years passed. No revival. Everything had diminished. We're now 50 years away from when Cyrus had dedicated or said that they could go back. But I want you to know God was still moving during that time. God was moving behind the scenes because at the beginning of the year, we talked about Esther. There was a new king that had come in, Ahasuerus, Xerxes, during this time. Even though God's not mentioned in the book of Esther, here we are during this idle time. Esther is working for such a time as this. It's a time to shine. So they were allowed to save the Jewish people. But then another 30 years passed. 80 years from the time when revival should have sprung out. You know, I thought about this church itself. It's been 60 years since this church was established. But here, this revival, 80 years from the time of Cyrus, 280 years from the time of Isaiah prophesying it, 150 years from Jeremiah declaring, you can go back. You know, you thought 70 years was a long time to wait to go back to the land. Another 80 years, and nothing is really taking place. And then there's another king that comes in named Artaxerxes, and he becomes the ruler. This is where we're beginning to meet Ezra. He was born in captivity, and then there's a second wave of revival. And I have her on the screen. There's a man named Ezra. And I want to look at Ezra just a few moments. You know, through the first few chapters, we talk about, or it talks in Ezra about the return of the Jews. And then we meet Ezra real quickly in chapters 7 and 8. And then 9 and 10, he reforms. You know, when revival comes, reformation comes too. Something changes. If nothing changes, then it's not revival because it brings us back to life. We begin hating that sin. Later we'll talk maybe next week about Nehemiah. But who is Ezra? Ezra was a lineal descendant of Phinehas. Phinehas was the grandson of Aaron. You know, Phinehas was a man that did not fall to everything that every man did. He was a Levite. He was a part of the godly priesthood. And Phinehas, over in the book of Numbers, you'll find, I think it's in the 21st chapter, he was grieved because the inhabitants, the Jewish people, were taking heathen wives. You know, God had spoke to them, do not do this, because if you do this, you're going to pull in their gods. You know, Peggy has a big influence on me. There's a big impact. And when you start, if you are unequally yoked, and I'm telling you about, if you're unequally yoked, you are drawn to the one that is stronger, the one that has the power over you. My dad used to tell my mom, you know, a woman can get a man to do almost anything she wants. It's true. It's true. But Phinehas was appalled. There was a man named Balaam. Balaam was not allowed to curse God's people. God stopped him. You know, if you read about Balaam's donkey, you know, it's kind of a story the children really love. A donkey that can talk. But God didn't allow Balaam to curse his people. So Balaam found another way. He knew that if he could intertwine and get people, the heathen people, mixed with God's people, that he could get them to worship, and he cursed them another way. But Phinehas was one that decided that's not going to be, and he slew. You know, you can think, thou shalt not kill. God allowed, through the power that he wanted in his people, to have these destroyed. So Phinehas destroyed. And because he destroyed that couple, or that in the camp or whatever, in their community, the right was restored, the mindset was restored not to have heathen relationships. And God promised through Phinehas that always his lineage, there would be priesthood and it would be operated. You know, Ezra was part of him. And Ezra, not being born in Jerusalem, he had a desire to serve in a temple. You know, he didn't have a temple in Babylon, but he desired to have the opportunity. So a second revival, 80 years. Okay, now I'm getting to where I really want to be here. The sounds of revival. What did it look like, the sounds of revival? I want you to go to the 8th chapter. And I'm going to read a couple of verses. And I want you to get in your heart what the sounds of revival, what it's going to take for revival to come to our church. When are you going to know that it's revival? What's it going to look like? What's it going to sound like? And how is it going to change you? Ezra 8, 21 through 23. And the word says, and there by the Ahava canal, I gave orders for all of us to fast and humble ourselves before our God. We prayed that he would give us a safe journey and protect us, our children, and our goods as we traveled. For I am ashamed to ask the king for soldiers and horsemen to accompany us and protect us from enemies along the way. After all, we have told the king our God's hand of protection is all on all who worship him, but his fierce anger rages against those who abandon him. So we fasted and earnestly prayed that our God would take care of us, and he heard our prayer. Heavenly Father, this morning I have taken time to lay out groundwork, but I'm asking you now that this verse, these verses or what you've shared with me that this church needs to hear. They need to hear the sounds of revival. They need to notice it and look for it every time it rings in their ears. And I ask you today that you would allow your word to go forth and it would not return void, but it would accomplish that which it was supposed to do. I give it to you today, Holy Spirit. Would you just get it deep into the hearts and minds of this people? In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You know, when I started thinking about the sounds of revival, I thought about spring. And as I was laying in my bed a couple of weeks ago, you know, it was dark still outside. I could see it. You know, there was nothing out there. But I could begin to hear the birds. You know, the birds began to echo and talk to each other. And as they talked to each other, it was just amazing to me, the things that were going on out in nature. And then as I went through the day, I started, you know, last Saturday was bad. I remember telling Peggy, you know, how can one Saturday change to the next? It's Ohio, you know, snow squalls one day, and it's 75 degrees the next Saturday. But I thought about the running waters that I've heard on the brooks and the gentle breezes and the moving of the trees. As I said, the birds chirping, lawnmowers all around me. I was the last in my neighborhood to mow my yard, but I heard no lawnmowers going everywhere. I heard tree trimmers, and I heard tractors moving and hammers pounding, people building new houses. And I thought, that's the sound of spring, isn't it? You hear those kind of things. Things are awakening. People become alive, and things begin to change. Of course, I think of the sunny skies. Man, it is beautiful today. Sometimes I don't want it to be so beautiful on Sunday because people find so much to do when it's beautiful. But it's sunny and the blue skies, and soon we'll see robin's nests, and we'll be trying to drive them away from our front doors out here because they'll leave all of their... Yeah. I look at the green grass and the budding trees. I told Peggy yesterday, I stood in our upstairs window and I watched squirrels in our trees, in our maple trees, and I didn't realize it, but squirrels eat buds. I didn't know that. I thought they just ate nuts and all of her stuff at the bird feeder. But they climbed, and they were eating all those blossoms off the trees, and I thought, well, these must be Yul Gibbons-type squirrels, you know? I don't know what's going on here. But the spring, the sounds and the birds and the silence even. I watched the rabbits. We have a couple rabbits around our house, and every time I mow, they come out of trees, and I watch as they set out there looking for mates. You know, we always talk about, what is that, Twitter pating, you tell me? Yeah, they're Twitter pating in the spring. I think she said that's from Bambi, right? Okay. Yeah, spring is about life, and it's about things, and we notice that, and I love it. But I thought, God, just as you allow people in the body of Christ, the people that live on this earth, to understand what spring sounds like, your people need to hear and understand what revival sounds like. And I thought about the first thing is, you know, when the birds, they sang that morning here a couple weeks ago, I heard that echoing sound. It just went back and forth, back and forth. It was almost like they was repeating each other. And I thought, you know, that's the way revival is. You know, in the scripture here, it said that Ezra got by the Ahava Canal, and he made a proclamation. He said something very profound. There was only 2,000 people, a very small group. You know, I understand there's times when real revival comes, everybody doesn't get on board. There are so many people that could have got on board. But Ezra, he was looking at who was around, and then one of the first things he said is, you know, where are the priests and the Levites? We're going back to the temple. We're going back to Jerusalem, and when we get there, I want people that know God. I just don't want descendants and people that have bloodlines. I want to know people that know how to get a hold of God. And he made sure that they were there, and then he made a proclamation. And I thought, it had to have echoed across. You know, we have a microphone, and I asked, is it working? You know, with 300 people, sometimes we wonder, but will it get to everyone? With 2,000 people being there, I'm sure somebody says, What did he say? Are you sure that's what he said? No, now, that's not what he said, is it? But you know, when revival comes, there is echoing, there's testimony. There are people that repeat resound the things that are going on. What did the pastor say? He said this, because God said this. I think it needs to be repeated. You know, I read about a town crier. You know, they used to have paid people that were criers. They went out when there's news they wanted to give. They went out and they rang a bell. And they not just sounded an alarm, they just were sounding the news. And I think as a church, what should be on your lips is that revival is in our midst. You need to repeat, and there needs to be echoing from you to the community. Oh, well, we go to church, it's dead. Do you think anybody wants something that's dead? Well, you know, how was church today? It's okay. How was the preacher's message? It's okay. It was wonderful because it came from God. It's God's word. And Ezra was saying, I'm making a proclamation here this morning. I thought, you know, sometimes things get old. It gets old. You get tired of hearing the same things. But there's people, there are so many that have come into this church that you don't even know what has happened in this church. I thought 60 years ago, yes, God started this church. There were two women that came into Wapak. They didn't come to Wapak first. They went to Lima first. Lima already had an Assembly of God church. But they came out of Bible college, and God stirred in them that there was revival to take place. They were supposed to go much like he did with Zerubbabel. There's a place that they needed to go to accomplish the things of God. They drove through Wapak, and they had a hunger. They said, this is the place. They started a storefront, and the history goes that during the first month or two that they were here, they made 400 home visits. 400. But the church didn't take off. The church was in a storefront, as I said, and kind of idle and dying, if you will. They still believed that God was going to send revival to this area 60 years ago, 59 years ago, 59 and a half, almost 60 years ago. The local Lutheran church there on 210 West Auglaize Street decided they could build their own church and get something bigger and better. This was an old Civil War era building. And they left it empty, and it was for sale. In June, 60 years ago, they opened it up for revival because the Assemblies of God helped them purchase it. But to open it up, they needed a preacher. And a preacher, you know, they needed something to stir things. So they found a preacher. And the preacher had a daughter that was married and had children already. But she would sing for him, and all of this was going on. But God was moving behind the scenes. You know, I've told this a few times. Some of you don't know. But after I was here for 6 or 8 months, there were family members of mine that told me that they were in their 80s, that told me that that revival preacher was my grandfather, that the singer that sang with my grandfather was my mother, and my mother was 6 months pregnant for me because I was born 3 months later. Those things, I believe, are not just a coincidence. Cyrus was known 200 years ago before the revival that was supposed to take place. But I want to tell you, over time, there were highs and low parts, and you're going to find that as I share in Ezra and Nehemiah. There were times when things got good and things went way down. And there were reasons for that. But God had a purpose for revival here in Wapak too. You need to know that. You need to get it in your heart. You know, people have told me, and I was sharing with a couple of people I'm mentoring with about sacrifice, the heart and sacrifice. I said, some people, I feel dirty almost when they say, you sacrificed so much to leave Honda to come to Wapak. I didn't sacrifice anything. Peggy's the one sacrificed. She sacrificed all her friends, her family that were around her at the time. And she had to follow me and have trust with me. I was miserable at Honda. I didn't want to be there. It wasn't about money. So I knew God wanted me here. But you know, if I had known the story ahead of time, it would have took no faith at all to come to Wapak. It would have took none because I'd say, God, it's you. But later he confirmed that with me. I thought that needs to be echoed. You need to know that. You need to be sure. Not because of me, but that God had a plan for Wapak. And there's times I have to remind myself of that when I think I'm finished or I'm done or whatever. You know, when I get my own pity parties, God's let me know I had a purpose for you. Don't be like Zerubbabel and lay there silent and let the temple go for 16 years. Sometimes you need these young ones to come up behind you and say, you know, we're going to finish this thing. We're going to let revival come in to our hearts. And I thought last week I shared with you the three years ago, God sent someone here to share a word of prophecy. And I don't know if disobediently or whatever, I took it. I thought, yeah, it sounds good. And I put it on the shelf. But I'm going to share it with you again this morning. Because as I believe what Ezra was doing there at that Ahava canal that day, he was saying some things. There had to be echoes of saying, yes, this is what he wants us to do. In this church body, if you weren't here, you need to know what God's already said about this church. It says, I have heard your petition that you desire more of me. Is that you? Is that you? A desire that I would pour out my spirit in this place. You would have also been seeking me concerning spiritual gifts. You say you want to happen in this place what has been happening on the mission field. I thought this morning at the end of the road, Baileana, you know, God, there's people getting saved. If a 100-year-old person can come to know you at the end of their life, God, that's revival. They tell me that after a person gets beyond their childhood years, it is almost a miracle to turn and go back toward God and to get saved. You know, Richard's an exception. He was in his 70s. He's 90 now. But a 100-year-old, it's happening on the mission field. I say to you this, are you needy and hungry enough? Will you search me with all your heart? Would you change your desires from the things of this world to spiritual things? I'm asking you, church, will you change your heart and desire from the things of this world to spiritual things? Remember this. I have heard the cry of my people, and I have planted this church in this place. I have chosen this place because of the descendants who have gone on before you and because the need is so great in this area. I have given you your leader as a gift to help you build a church, a watchtower, just to help you. This is your church that you will be set on a hill in this land, a watchtower, to be a beacon of light and hope that you can pluck up and tear down strongholds of the enemy that have been here for hundreds of years. I told you last week I was studying about the Indian heritage in this area. You know, there has been things for hundreds of years that have been strongholds in this area that God wants to break with this revival. I have led many people of different faiths here. Some of those are you. You know, think about the different people in your backgrounds, Catholic and Presbyterian and Methodist and Baptist and Nazarene and nothing. Many of you, nothing. From great distances so that you could come back to me. I'm instructing you to let out the cords of your tents. Now, that's a hard thing to do sometimes when you're just safe right in your own little spot. But he's saying to let out the cords of your tents and build me a place where my Shekinah glory, I heard Bill say that this morning, Shekinah glory, or the manifested presence of God is, can dwell and where men can worship and praise me in the beautifulness of his holiness. If you want my glory, my gifts, and my power, you must be ready for it. I'm stopping here a minute. Are you ready? We're not ready yet. I go where I'm wanted. I will not go where I am not wanted. And where man does not believe in my power, you are going to change in appearance as a church body as you won't look like, act like, or smell like the same people you were before. You will begin to look like your father. It will be broadcast all over the region concerning the great things I'm doing here. I will do this, but remember, you must do your part. Also remember, all will not accept it or want it. Some will deny my power and my presence in unbelief. My church grows when the kingdom suffers persecution. There's going to be persecution. I've heard words of knowledge already said, prepare, but don't be surprised. There's persecution that's coming. My church grows because of that. I will send signs and wonders here. I will do the miraculous. I will show up and show out to save the lost. That's what it's about. It's about saving the lost. To heal the sick, to deliver those who are bound by spirits. You know, there's so many times we've seen miracles and we've seen God do little things. But God's already promised us that he's going to allow miracles to begin to take place. There's going to be people that cancer word has just consumed for years and years and years, that we're going to be able to curse in the name of Jesus. And we're going to say, be gone, and that's going to be gone because he said these signs should follow those that believe. I will do the unexplainable and the impossible. Don't be afraid of opposition. Praise me through it, and remember, I am with you, and I will do great things among you. for you have asked me out of a sincere heart, thus says the Lord this day. I'm talking about echo, and you're saying, Pastor, I'm getting tired of hearing about that. I heard that last week. I'm getting tired about the stories. God spoke into my spirit this past week that it's about the echoing. You know, Ezra was saying, I have something I want you to do. Everybody get your attention toward me. And he did. So you need to echo too. You need to echo revival. There needs to be sounds in your life that echo everything about revival. I've seen some things posted on Facebook or on the worship page about revival. You know, it's got to get in you for you to be echo it out. It's got to be felt by you for you to be able to share with others. So I encourage you, let that be the first sound. The second sound of revival is the gurgling sounds. Now, I thought about this morning. I thought, man, that doesn't sound real good. Maybe gurgling's not the right word. Maybe the groaning or the growling sound is a little better. But God had spoke to me about gurgling. You know, I thought about how the brooks in nature gurgle. And I hear the little repeat of the insects gurgling. They're just making a funny sound. And I thought, God, revival's like that. You know, real quickly, Ezra told the people, we're going to fast. We are going to fast. And I thought, soon as you hear the word fast, most of the church says, I mean, you talk... But the real gurgling comes after about the first day. The real gurgling when the stomach starts growling and it's, you know, maybe the first meal for some of you. When lunchtime comes and you're thinking about it, it's like, I wish you'd hurry finish because I'm gurgling already. But, you know, really gurgling happens down in the lower intestines when there's something that needs to get out. That's real politically correct, isn't it? It's not even politics. That's anatomically correct. But the gurgling sounds come from fasting. I'll tell you, you begin to fast. I remember the first time that I fasted for 3 days. I was only 22, 23 years old. I fasted for someone's healing. It meant something to me. Corporately, we fasted. It was the greatest time of my life. I remember that my favorite meal was biscuits and gravy, and I had already determined on that Saturday evening at the end of my three-day fast, I was having biscuits and gravy. But you know what? The biscuits and gravy didn't taste so good. I was full, and it wasn't what I really wanted. It wasn't the right substance to replace the fast. But Ezra is saying, we're going to go on a trip here. We're going on a long trip. We're going on a 1,000-mile trip, and I should be giving you carbohydrates. I should be filling you up with potatoes and the things that will give you strength, and you can live off your fat and things. And he's saying, no, we're going to fast. We're going to do something because I don't like what's coming. I'm afraid to ask, and I don't want to ask the king for reinforcements and troops. You know, in 1,000 miles, there's a lot of robbers. If you read the scriptures here, as I just read, and you get the background, there was gold and silver and precious things. There was all kinds of wealth on this caravan of 2,000 people. And all it would have taken is a small army to take it all away from them. And here Ezra's saying, I got a bunch of preachers. Preachers don't know how to fight. He's saying, I need you, God. And in revival, if you don't hear the sound of something going on in your stomach, you know, later I think in the verse maybe 21 or 23, he begins to tell the reason. Maybe it's a little further than that down. I'm not sure. But what he begins to say is, it's because we need to be totally dependent on you, God. You know, when you begin to lose nourishment in your body says, you need something. And it reminds us we need the Almighty God. And the sounds of gurgling needs to take place in this congregation. Revival's not going to come till gurgling starts happening, till that stomach begins to growl. Then there's the other thing. He says, we're going to fast and we're going to pray. You know, I thought, that's the hush and the groaning sound. You know, the word says that we are to pray, and pray and fasting. In Romans 8, 22 and 23, it's not on the screen, but it talks about creation groans. From the very beginning, we as believers have groaned to the day that we're looking for our Creator to come back and make everything right, to where we can be a part of God. We have to groan for revival. We have to want it more than anything else. It's that silence at times. You know, in nature, as we look at the spring, there are times where everything's silent and just, you know, you just hear the breezes and it's quiet, and every once in a while, then I'll hear something shaking up in a tree, and there's little creatures, you know, fighting and playing and frolicking and doing all kinds of things. And I thought, you know, there's times when I pray, there's times of prayer where everything's silent, when I'm trying to hear from God, when I'm listening. And then there's times where there's groaning, when I'm praying and interceding in the Spirit. There's times where I just need to not ask God. I need to begin to tell him how awesome he is. I need to groan and say, from the very beginning, creation, God, I have been looking for you. I've been looking for your coming. And I'm looking for revival. Praying and interceding. You know, in Romans 8:26, it talks about God wants us to pray with that kind of groanings in the Spirit. I read a story this week on E.F. Hutton. You never hear that? When he speaks, people listen, and everything stops. You know, God speaks sometimes, and we don't listen. We don't have the groaning. We don't even have the reverence. You know, the scripture said we have to humble ourselves. I think Ezra told them to humble themselves, to fast and pray and humble yourselves. We've never got to the place where we stop and reverence the sound and the voice of God. But with E.F. Hutton, things went real well through the late 1800s, through the 1900s, but they hit a snag and things were really going bad. And it took a grandson in 2012 here to revive that company and allow it to come back. And again, because of the stocks and the things and the problems that they'd had. But I thought, how do we get from here? How do we get from the Ahava Canal to Jerusalem? How do we get from here to there? I'm telling you, church, this is what I'm calling for as your pastor. I don't know that I've ever done this as a pastor, but I'm calling for a solemn time of prayer and fasting this week. I don't know what your plans are, and I don't know what you can do, what you can't do, but as your pastor, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to withhold the food from my stomach so I can realize how dependent I am on God, that I need him for everything. Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. I know Peggy's thinking, well, Friday I'm going away to a women's conference and we're going to have just all kinds of fun. I don't know what you need to do. I don't know what your health conditions are. I don't know. And I think you need to use wisdom of that. But when Ezra called for a solemn time of prayer and fasting, he knew he was in trouble. He knew that there was a revival that he was spoken in his spirit. God had put in there that we're to go back on this long journey. And we cannot do it unless we pray and fast. And that's what I'm calling for this church. You can say, Pastor, I can't do it that much. Can you do something? Can you fast? You know, it's food. God's speaking to me food this time. So many times I've talked about give up TV, give up this, give up this. You know what? In order for your stomach to realize that you're being this mortal vessel of yours, you know, most of us, you know, again, my dad used to say, a man, you know, anything from a man is through his stomach. You know, if a woman can cook good enough, you can almost keep your man, you know. I don't know. I don't know that that's true, you know. That's not always true. But if you have nothing in there, it's going to remind you how much you need an awesome God. From here to there. We're here today. We're not in revival yet. You hear me, church? If we're going to get there, it's going to take prayer and fasting. So I'm placing this. This is a mantle I'm placing out there. Whether you choose to allow it to lay on you or not, depends on whether you're going to be that remnant that is going to experience revival. You know, I don't want anybody, I don't want to tag onto anyone. You know, there's times where people just grab on the coattails of something else and just get pulled along. I want to stand before God, and I want to be just full charge. I don't want to have to go and be pulled along. You decide for yourself what God's saying to you. The next sound that I had is the swishing sound. God, what are you saying here? You know, the scripture here, it says at the Ava Canal, I don't want to ask for the king's help. I'm going to depend on God's mighty hand. I'm going to depend, and later I think it says that they depended on God's mighty hand. And I thought the hand of God in Ezekiel, it talks about the man of God. You know, the Spirit of God had left because of the sin of the people or whatever. But Ezekiel began to feel something. and he felt a swishing sound. He felt air moving. He felt something going on around him, and it was the cherubims. Those are angels. Their wings were fluttering, and it says, as they began to flutter. Now, you want to hear from God? You got to hear the swishing sound. God talks in swishing language here because it says that those angels' wings became like the mighty voice or God Almighty's voice. If you want to hear from God, you've got to hear those kind of noises. I thought about God's almighty hand. I need God's hand. No revival is revival without God's hand in it. You know, I believe the psalmist talks about that God had the ability, or he did, you know, he created this universe with his finger or whatever. It relates to that somewhere. I'll have to look it up. But I thought he didn't use hardly any of his energy or any of his power or any of his ability to create this universe. But then I looked over in Isaiah 53 this week. You know, as Isaiah 53 begins to talk about Jesus Christ, how he's bruised, wounded for our transgressions, how he's bruised with our iniquities, for our iniquities, the chastisement of his peace was upon us, and by his stripes we are healed. It begins to talk about, in the very first verse of 53, it says, the strong arm of God. The strong arm of God. Some of us have forgot what the strong arm of God is. The strong arm of God was that salvation on the cross. It may have not taken much to build this universe, but it took an awful lot to buy redemption for mankind. He gave his son, Jesus Christ, for us. And unless we hear swishing sounds, unless we feel the sound of the Almighty God in our lives, that he begins to talk and wake us up, we're missing revival. If all you do is hear an orator, that's not revival. Revival is God himself speaking to his people. This morning, he's speaking to you. He wants to hear that swishing sound. I think you have to begin to desire it. You got to begin to say, God, I want to hear that sound. I want to feel the rush of angels' wings. I've heard people sing that song, I feel the rush of angels' wings. I sing glory. It's on his face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Church, revival will come when you begin to hear that swishing sound. It says, and there by the Ava Canal, I gave orders for all of us to fast and humble ourselves before our God. We prayed that he would give us a safe journey and protect us, our children, and our goods as we traveled. For I was ashamed to talk to ask, or ashamed to ask the king for the soldiers and horsemen to accompany us. I shared that with you. After all, we had told the king, this is what they had told the king. We go out in the community and we say, God's hand is mighty. God's hand is good. God is this and God is this. And then we live in defeat. It says our God's hand of protection is on all who worship him. Amen. You know, I read a story this week. It happened in 1950 in Beatrice, Nebraska. How many have heard of Beatrice, Nebraska? I Google some things sometimes and they come up. And it was talking about the church choir. Diane, you'll be interested in this. There were 15 members of the church choir. All were late for practice. That never happens to you guys, does it? But all were late for 10 different reasons. That meant a couple of them must have rode with each other. But every one of them were late. They were supposed to be there at 7:20. At 7:25, the church exploded everything to the ground. Now, don't tell me from now on I'm going to be late because something bad could happen. I want to make sure. But I thought, God's mighty hand, how many times has God's mighty hand looked over you? Caused you to miss an accident. Oh, I almost got killed. I almost had this happen. I almost had that happen. I had this crazy flat tire. And God's hand may have been working in your life. That's the way those swishing wings, you got to hear God. You got to know what he's doing, that his almighty hand. And the final thing, it's called a moving sound. You know, we used to sing a song, Saints on Higher Ground, one by one they overcome. You know, it was called shouting sound, I think that one was. But this is moving sound. I looked in the scripture, it talks about in the 31st verse. I don't have it here on the screen. Or do I? I do have it on the screen. We broke camp. I like this part. After all that, after 3 days of fasting and prayer, they're heading for Jerusalem 1,000 miles away. We broke camp at the Ava Canal on April 19th and started off to Jerusalem. and the gracious hand of our God protected us and saved us from the enemies and bandits along the way. So we arrived safely in Jerusalem, where we rested for 3 days. The 3 days that they had fasted, they rested when they got to Jerusalem. Now, this was a five-month trip. This was not an easy thing. But I thought about, there was a sound when they broke camp. You know, when we break camp here, you know, I watched the Ohio State spring game yesterday, replay. I didn't watch it live because it was too nice outside. And I was here for a while, too. But I watched some of it, and it, you know, when they break huddle, when they break, you know, something major, there's a noise, and there's something loud that goes on. There was a sound that took place when they broke camp. I imagine when that 3 days was over, they were ready to eat. You know, when they broke camp, they were probably saying, they probably had every munchie they had, could find along the way just to keep on eating. But I thought, all of the solemn fasting and assembly, the prayer, everything, all the preparation that we do here in prayer, it'll do us no good if we stay on the riverbank. Now, church, this is where I really want to go today because I'm going to lead into next week. If we pray and fast this week and we finish on Friday and we go to Selah on Saturday and we watch something else on Saturday and we come here next Sunday, same old, same old. If we don't start moving, if there's no marching feet, if there's nothing going on in our spirits when praise and worship is going on, if there's nothing happening in us, then we prayed and fasted for nothing. Do you hear me? If you don't decide I'm going to get up after God equips me, after he makes me realize what I need in my life and begin to move, you know, I think we have to pray. I'm not telling you not to pray. But I don't want to be sitting on the riverbank when revival comes to Wapak. I don't want to be on the sidelines when revival comes. You can say, well, I'll just join in at that time. I'll slide in at that time. I can tell you, when those 2,000 people left, those stragglers weren't coming in behind. Either you were going when Ezra went, or you weren't going. But Wapak is our Jerusalem. That's where we're going. We're going to Wapak. I want to be here. I want to be in this church when God brings revival. I'm determined. You know, there's times I didn't know what my future was. I want to be in Wapak when the prophecy is finished. I want to understand Zerubbabel. I got to believe he was still hoping and wanting. But you know, he led that first charge, but it wasn't enough. You're going to find out Ezra's charge wasn't enough either, because there's going to continue to be opposition. There's going to be continued reformation that's needed. There's going to be reformation. After God brings revival to us, there's going to have to be change taking place. It can't stay the same. It can't be like it was when you were on the bank. So I want you to spend your 3 days praying and fasting. Then I want you to begin to get busy. Saturday's your busy day. If you're supposed to be at a women's conference, you be there. If you're supposed to be talking to people in the community, begin to do that. Some of you got relatives you need to invite here to church. Revivals, you know, that's a part of it. Well, you know, it's everything I can do just to get here myself. You know, if your relatives see a desire in you to be in the house of God, they'll want to know. You know, and I realize the miracles and things that come, that'll draw people. But I want to be a part of the real revival. So I want you to send out cards. I want you to make phone calls. I want you to start walking. I want you to get in step. I want there to be a sound of revival in your feet, because if you're not moving, revival's not in you. I realize that some of you may be incapacitated. You may be limited. I talked to my mom and I took her to a doctor this week. I hope I don't have to take her to doctors anymore. I hope that there's a change in her. You know, really, I want to. I'm not trying to embarrass her, but her legs don't work so good anymore. I want to see those work again. But mile after mile, day after day, there needs to be the sound, the moving sounds of revival. And we get there, we'll know it's time for revival. When you hear those echoing sounds, when you hear those gurgling sounds, when you hear the sounds of groaning in the spirit, when you hear the sounds of that swishing of the wings of an angel as if it's God's, you hear God's voice, revival's coming. Just as sure, you know, 2 weeks ago I heard those sounds of spring. And after I saw the snow last Saturday, I mean, it was bad in some places. It was hard to drive through. And I thought, we didn't have this all winter. I'm going to tell you, church, there's things that you haven't faced ever before that you're going to have to face. There's going to be opposition. But if you can make it through that, there couldn't have been a more beautiful day than yesterday. Spring came, and spring is here. And they tell me it's going to be here from now on now. It may be 40s at night, and you know, but Brian's going to be in that tractor. He's probably already been in it, right? No? Oh, he was taking pictures. That was just a photo op. Guys, don't let it be a photo op. Revival has to come. And those will be the signs that you hear, the echoing. You're going to hear my voice. You're going to hear the word of God. You're going to hear that. You're going to feel this. You are. You're going to feel those wings of an angel. I just believe that you will hear God's voice like never before. And you got to start moving. If you stay the way you are, it's not going to happen. Praise and worship, would you come back? You know, every revival starts with repentance first. We've been ministering about repentance. You know, it's hard to pray and fast if you haven't repented first, isn't it? And I think an altar is a good place. If Ezra could have taken his people and said, this is what we're going to do for the next 3 days, you're going to need strength. You're going to need to come to me. I've had people talk to me about the altar, and there's times where people really wonder, if you come to the altar, it's a place. I see people think about it as a place of shame. But it is a wonderful place. It's a place of relationship. It's a place of dependence. It doesn't always have to be because you're throwing something ugly down. It could be because you're saying, God, I want to lift you up. And this morning as we head and we go from here to there, next week I want to go there. I want to be where God wants us to be. I want to hear and see the fires of revival come among us. I don't believe if you pray and fast that God won't show himself big. He says, I will show up and I will show out. You know, God don't have to show off. But he says, I'll show up and I'll show out. And I want him to show out. And he does it through us. He shows out of us. But this morning as you stand, if you'd stand, I want to have a corporate prayer time. I just want to fill up these altars. If you have the physical ability to move toward the front of the church, I want you to realize you're standing at a place right now in the history of this community, not just this church. You're standing in a point of history that God wants to do something wonderful, that he's been waiting maybe hundreds of years. God's time is not our time, but I believe this is the right time, a time to shine, such a time as this. He's putting it all together. He's connecting the dots. Now he needs us to begin to move. And as you begin to step out of your seats, church, I would that everyone that has the ability to move would make your way to the front of this church. Would you begin to do that? As I proclaim, as I begin to echo this, and I want you to ask God, God, how and what am I going to do? What is my part in the revival? Because God's already said, I will show up. Now he wants you to show up. God, today as we kneel before you, a holy God, as we bow before you for every need and dependency that we have, I ask you to give us strength. Give this people strength and faith to know that this is you, God. To know that you, beyond a shadow of a doubt, is speaking to this people. As we fast and we pray, God, not to show off for us, but that we would be humble and obedient to you, that our hearts would open up and say, this is what I want for my community. God, I want to see you in a big way. I want to see how you operate, that you are the kingdom. This is what it is. And God, is your big arm begins to stretch over this congregation. Would you speak things into their lives during this 3 days? I'm asking for the whole week, but during these 3 days specifically, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, let my words echo in their hearts. Let the sound of revival come to them. God, let them know that you hear their voice and you'll talk to them during this time, God. That you will begin to do things, and there may be opposition, but you will equip them for the path and the journey they're about to take. God, I want to hear the sounds of revival. I don't want to see the snow squalls anymore, but I want to see your manifest presence, your Shekinah glory, shine over this place. Would you do that today, God? Would you let those leave here today knowing that you see their hearts? If there's those among us that says, God, I can't do it, I don't know what I would do, speak to them and let them know what pleases you, what part they could have in this. It's up to you, God. It's not about work. It's about a right heart. Let us know. Let us be touched today. God, your song says, I give myself away so you can use me. Let us give ourselves to you today, God. This may not be in a Hava canal, but spiritually it is. It's a place and it's a point where we're bowing down to you, a humble God. God, speak to us. Let us be still when we need to be still. Let us hear you, God. I want the sounds of revival to echo. So you